Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Power9 Podcast. My name is Mika. I'm one of your hosts alongside the future bro, Alfian Put.
Hey, guys.
Yeah, that was a very lazy point. Like you the future bro.
Future pro.
Yeah.
Oh, shit.
How are you doing this week?
Well, I got hit by a sore throat because I tried casting on Wednesday.
Oh, yeah. Now you know it's not an easy job.
I did the super hype caster type of casting, you know.
Like, wow!
Holy shit, wow! And I should not do that.
Yeah, this is not a... Well, that's the thing. Like, I found the rhythm for me to do the casting. So I think I'm going to give up Wednesday nights.
Yeah.
You guys have to take over.
I'll take over. It's okay.
Yeah.
I love casting.
You love casting, but you have no idea what's going on in Modern.
So. But we're going to cast Smodern now.
Smodern.
That's what I call it.
Smodern.
That's what I'm calling it. Then I will know what's happening.
Standard Modern, right? Anyway. Yeah, we're just probably going to move away from the Modern.
Yeah.
Because we've done all the matches, like there's not a lot of innovation that we've seen.
Yeah,
so
everyone's we see the same guys like every day playing the same decks, like shit.
Yeah, so we're gonna do Postmodern. But anyway, more about that later on in the show. Let's start the show.
Yeah, man.
Yeah, if you're listening or if you're
watching.
If you're just listening, you can watch us. You can go on down to youtube.com. Otherwise you can just catch every episode. The latest episode on power9podcast.com or mtgcast.com on iTunes. So let's get on with the show.
Yeah, man.
Okay. That's the end of the show.
Did you say something like, let's do every episode, we start with our week in magic? Something like that.
Do we do week in magic? Okay, so I want to do user comments first.
All right, let's go.
Let's do a user comment. Let's mix things up.
Oh, man.
So crazy.
Let's get jiggy with it. Yeah.
Okay. All right. Let's mix things up. This week, I had a very long... user comment by our favorite commenter. You're the only commenter, that's why you're our favorite.
Yeah.
There are a few guys who commented on the Modern is Dead episode.
Mm.
And clearly, there's no objection to it. So Modern is clearly dead. You all agree with us very, very clearly. So yeah,
either that or our points were just really good, so just convince them.
All 50 of you.
All 50 of you.
I mean, all 10 of you.
Couple.
Alright, so Brella, okay, you feel famous. Thank you for reading my comment. I feel famous. I started playing MTG during Return to Ravnica, so 2012 and a little bit when I was a real little kid. I have never been interested in playing Modern, reasons being I'm perfectly happy with going to pre-releases, drafts, Commander and Cubes, not to mention Standard. I find deck building as somewhat of an enjoyable challenge that isn't very rewarding, as in I don't find myself winning very much. Hey, isn't that what... Can you not relate to that?
I can completely relate.
So it goes on. Maybe we'll do this as a topic next time. How often do each of you guys sit down and play each format? What's your favorite way to play? Is Frontier gaining momentum in Singapore? And I have some friends that are interested.
That's going to be today's episode.
Yeah, that's actually going to be today's episode. But we'll talk about that in a while. So thank you for your comments. If you want your comments read out during the show, do let us know. And let us know whether we should put the comments at the end so that you will have to listen to the entire show and then they read out my comments at the end of the episode. So our stats.
I don't know. I think it kind of depends on the comment.
Yeah.
Maybe.
Then our stats would show people watch the very end.
Oh.
You know, they watch. It looks like they watch the entire show. Anyway, also something that I want to amend myself about last week.
Okay.
So I want to correct that Blood Hall Priest, right? It will trigger if you use Bumat Courier.
Yeah, yeah.
Because discarding is part of the cost. I thought discarding your entire hand was part of the effect.
Oh man, it's a cost.
Yeah, it's part of the cost. So, my bad. You discard your entire hand and then that you put the...
So much for the mana drains.
Yeah. I don't deserve my mana drains. Anyway, for those of you who did not catch it, we're correcting it for you anyway. Okay, so we start off, traditionally we start off each show with our week in Magic.
Oh yeah.
So Alfian, what would you do?
I tried to do the sound but I saw it. Anyway, anyway. Yeah,
we had an episode that was very similar to this in Porto. One of my friends flew in from Singapore.
Yeah, yeah.
Wei Kiong, and he came on the episode. So, but that day itself, he started losing his voice for no apparent reason. It's not like we were shouting or anything.
Yeah,
he just
yeah.
lost his voice, and so he came on the show and was like, "So yeah, no."
Yeah, I lost my voice yesterday. You hear my voice? It was so cool. I sound like a Batman.
I'm Batman.
Yeah, but anyway, because I wanted to play PBDQ yesterday, actually. Because okay. I thought after my 0-3 record at FNM the day before, mm-hmm. actually I realized like a lot of things on the deck. Like, I was keeping hands to... I was not mulliganing liberally enough.
Yeah, I think this... and you were playing... You gotta explain like what deck you're playing.
Yeah, okay. So basically, I was playing against Sultai Eldrazi, one of the new, fresh, upcoming standard decks. Wow, cool. It had this really cool curve, like this conduit into Thought Knot, into Virus Girl Hulk, into Haha You Die.
Yeah.
So I think I had to keep a hand with maybe Nerd Ape, Key to the City, or Smuggler's Copter into Disintegration to handle their drops.
Uh-huh, yeah.
But so... I realized against specific matchups, you have to keep like very specific hands with this deck.
It's possible, yeah. So I think most of the matchups you can keep. There are certain combinations of cards in hand that you can keep. So for example, if you got Key to the City and Lupine Prototype, then I think that's a keeper. Yeah, like with enough lands, two lands. If then there are the matches where. Like, if you do see specific matches, you have to keep a certain set of cards. You need X number of creatures.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, especially if you play against blue-white.
Yeah.
Then, or like some version with white that you know has removals, then you definitely want to keep a hand
with more creatures.
More creatures, yeah. Because that's the only way you're getting in the damage. So, yeah.
Yeah, so I realized that my mentality came from like other decks, like, keeping hands.
I need to keep like six or seven cards, right?
But then I realized that the more I... But then my good friend Chun Hao, he mm-hmm. told me that when playing an aggro deck, you typically will only see 15 cards. So you better keep a good hand.
Yeah,
I think about it, oh yeah, that's right. Mm.
Vintage, okay, so in comparison with Vintage, I think this format is really fast or has gotten very fast. Mm-hmm. So your opening seven really needs to be the one that wins you the game.
Or six.
Or the six. Or five.
Or four.
Yeah. These cards need to win you the game, because if you don't, you know, if you're banking on you're gonna draw this land, maybe I draw this third land, or maybe my opponent's got a slow hand, or you just keep a do-nothing hand, you're going to lose the game, because you're not going to get past, like, you know, 7-8 draws in the game. Like, and even if you do, you get to that 7th or 8th draw, it's too late.
Yeah. I also learned that Smoldering Marsh and Forbidding Ruins is not a keep.
For sure. Although in some cases it is.
Yeah, in some cases
maybe
it is,
you believe hard enough.
Maybe you have a Nerd Ape and then like you have a key and you're like, okay, I think this could work out even if I don't draw a land.
No, it's too slow.
Oh yeah, it's too slow.
Oh, well. It's way too slow. Yeah, that's the thing. Like, we have that mentality if I draw this land. And especially if you're playing this deck is, you know, easy to go hellbent. Like, you need to go hellbent for this deck to work very, very well.
Well, in before strategies, they just mount to four and like, you know, hellbent turn two, woohoo!
turn two, drop the wolf, and then turn three, start attacking with a 5-5.
With unblockable.
Yeah. Oh yeah, with unblockable, like, yay!
And then, like, fiery temper, your face, boosh,
Yeah. Oh, it's so good. Feels good, right?
Yeah, I think I got a hang. I think I got a hang of the dad. I understand the mentality now. I just need to get in some practice games later on.
Yeah, that's good.
At least for the best, I got sore throat. I didn't go to the PPTQ anyway.
Yeah, don't waste your cash, man. Yeah. Like, I think a bit more practice. This deck is a competitor.
Yeah,
definitely. Could have been.
I'm still. I'll ask you later on. Like, I'll consult you later on specific matchups. But for now, I think I'd like to say that this deck pretty good actually. I just need to learn how to use it.
It feels powerful.
Powerful, but I just need to know what hands to keep.
Yeah, I think that's important. Like even yesterday when I was playing Standard Showdown, I lost the last game because I think I just kept dumb hands.
Yeah.
Like I know I mulligan very aggressively, but even at the end of the mulligan, like I made. Okay, so no, I didn't keep dumb hands, but I made bad decisions.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and because I kept pushing, because in my head I was like, okay, you gotta be aggressive, be aggressive, be aggressive, be aggressive. And sometimes you just forget that, okay, there's the tactical play.
Uh-huh.
There's the much needed tactical play, which is, oh, the guy drops the Avacyn. Now I kill your dude. You know, instead of getting blown out in both situations. So. The deck is very intricate. Like it's not the
there's this hidden layer of
Before you go hellbent, right? There's so many decisions and there's so many possibly unintuitive plays that you have to do. Like if you have your Lupine prototype, and like you have one card in hand which is unlicensed disintegration, do you just use the unlicensed disintegration? Sometimes yes, but sometimes no. So you got to be smart about that.
Another thing, this was actually a technical misplay on my part. Mm-hmm. I was playing against a black green Aetherworks Marvel.
Yeah.
Okay, so I had lost Legacy in hand. He was at four mana. I was close to killing. He was at 10 or something.
Okay.
I was like, okay, over here I have killed a city and two disintegrations in my hand.
Okay.
And like I don't know what I had. I think I was like a scrounger.
Okay.
So in my head, I was thinking, okay, Mick told me I should take out the Ishkana first with Lost Legacy.
Right.
So I Lost Legacy the Ishkana.
Okay.
True enough, yet the Ishkana was going to draw turn 5.
Okay. So that goes.
So then he marveled. Then he top decked a marvel, a tune, and got into Emrakul.
Oh, man.
Which had me thinking, if I left the Ishkana and instead I went from Emrakul, I could have just disintegrated that and hit through the Ishkana with the Key to the City and the Shadowless Challenger.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Actually, no. I think always go for Emrakul first. Like, if you're going against the Black-Green Delirium, go for Ishkana first. But if you go against Aetherworks Marvel, you always hit the Emrakul first. Because that's the only thing that makes you lose the game.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Ishkana's not going to do anything. Like, Ishkana is just like, okay, I've got lots of blockers.
Yeah.
Oh, but I've got Key to the City, I've got Lupine Prototype. That's 5 damage a turn.
Yeah, maybe, so maybe I misheard your instructions.
Yeah. It's possible, yes. But this, I mean, I learned this last week because I lost terribly to Aetherworks Marvel deck because I just gave up a Lost Legacy to try to be aggressive and just got blown out from it.
Yeah, that's exactly what I did too.
Okay.
How about your week in Magic?
My week? Well, I got to play FNM. We got a draft.
Cool.
I thought I drafted a pretty neat deck, but it turns out it wasn't that neat. Actually, it was kind of cool. I like the deck quite a bit. But yeah, I seem to just keep like 2 landers, 3 landers and like, I just don't draw any more lands, and
feels bad, man.
I don't know. Like my deck had lots of 2-drops and lots of 3-drops, and I thought, you know, I just this thing. But somehow I just drew the only 2 6-drops in my deck. Okay, that's cool.
Oh well.
And it happened multiple times throughout the night. So maybe I was just keeping bad hands. Maybe I was unlucky.
Yeah, I think one bad habit I really need to get rid of is how to not keep bad hands because that's
very important. Like I think you know, mulliganing should not be seen as the penalty. Yeah,
should see it as a privilege.
It's a reward. Yeah, it's a privilege. It's a reward for good play. And then I got to play Standard Showdown. Standard Showdown, I wanted to brew a very weird deck. I wanted to brew Harness the Lightning, Harness the Storm deck. Gain life and shit like that. So Jeskai Harness the Storm. Jeskai Harness the Storm. So there's the one mana, gain 5 life, right?
Yeah.
Then you got like Blessed Alliance, you got Take Inventory, you got Galvanic Bombardment, then you got Harness the Storm. Oh yeah.
Okay, how did that work out?
No, I did not build it. Oh. So I just ran with my black red
Hellbent
deck, and it was like, I felt so bad because I got paired up with
two new players.
Yeah.
Hey, bully.
Yeah, I felt like a bully.
Bully alert.
So good. Yeah.
And you still did go
I still lost, you know, I lost the last game.
Who you lost to?
I lost to, who was it? Zizie.
What do you lose?
Yeah, I lost against a blue-white flash, which actually is one of the easier matchups.
How do you play that matchup, actually?
You just go fast.
Oh, okay.
Like, literally, you go, like, key to the city, loop by prototype.
Do you remove your creatures?
Sometimes.
Okay.
I think in those instances, you want to try to bait out their
spell quellers,
after that you kill the spell quellers.
Okay, fair enough.
Yeah, that is generally the way that you want to play. You really want to keep a very aggressive hand against them, because, you know, they go like Declaration in Stone, and this thing, okay, fine, you get rid of some of my creatures, but I still got lots more creatures to come. So,
okay.
Yeah, that's one of those decks that you want to be like creature heavy. You don't want to just like die to, you know, just a single removal, two double removal, and then you're just blown out.
That's fair. Okay.
Okay, so.
Enough of our rambling.
Yeah. Enough about our Wing Magic. Let's talk about the news. Last week we didn't cover it. We were supposed to cover it, but GP Chiba. And GP Chiba.
Chiba. Mark, was he going? Mark went.
Yeah, Mark went.
He did the...
Did not even do day two.
Well, he did say he faced some very good players, though.
Excuses.
Well, I think he enjoyed himself. That's
yeah, I think... No, I don't think Mark got enough practice on Modo for the...
But he enjoyed himself.
Yeah, he did go for the Super Sunday series for Standard.
How did that work out?
Not good.
Oh, well.
He lost his win and in, so...
Wow, feels bad, man.
Feels bad. He was playing the Madu Vehicles deck. Yeah, it's a try-hard deck. It is the four-color Madu Vehicles deck.
Madu Blue.
Yeah.
Oh, man. Why don't you just play something like simpler, like Blue White Flash or Green Black Delirium?
It's greenless vehicles. But yeah, congratulations to Kentaro Yamamoto playing the Sneak and Show deck.
Oh, I can't say it.
Turn one kill. His opponent did not have.
Oh, by the way,
anything.
I need to say something. Hold on.
Yep.
I need to go on Shadowverse. There's this. Okay, apparently, right? Someone in from Team Cygames, right? Won something. So
on Shadowverse.
No, on MTG.
Okay.
Because Team Cygames has their own MTG team.
Yeah, no, Team Cygames, I believe, sponsors Kentaro Yamamoto.
Yeah, so because he won, all of us got free packs.
Like
15 of them. Holy shit, thanks Kentaro, you the boss.
Oh man, that is... What the hell, man?
I'm so happy.
So easy.
Just play Shadowverse, guys. Don't play after play Shadowverse, guys.
Oh, it's created by Team Cygames, is it?
Yeah,
Like the guys from Team Cygames.
Oh, no, it's... who's this guy? Kentaro Yamamoto. Yeah, yeah. He won his first 2016 in us.
Oh, yeah, yeah. This look, his first GP win this year. Oh, come on. And because of that, you guys get free packs.
Yeah!
That's bullshit.
Feels good, man.
Absolute bullshit.
You have to play us just jelly.
Yeah. So, I should just go and download it right now and just get like free 16 packs, right?
Yeah, lor. No, we can just get 35 packs.
Oh. Why 35 packs?
For completing the tutorial, then they get
25. Oh, then you get... Oh.
Including this, you get like 16 more.
Oh, what the hell?
Play, free
no,
packs.
No, I don't. I'm lazy. Anyway, So yeah, congrats to him. He was playing the Sneak and Show deck. Very cool. The first game ended on turn one, which was amazing.
What was he? How did that work?
Okay, so his deck has City of Traders. So he just dropped City of Traders. He did not... I thought he had the... what's that card that allows you to look at your opponent's hand?
Thoughtseize?
No.
Detection Probe.
Detection Probe, yeah. I thought he went Git Probe. So then I watched the replay. He didn't even have Git Probe. So he went Lotus Petal.
Okay.
Followed up by, I think, City of Traitors.
Okay.
Cracked the Lotus Petal for blue. Then City of Traitors for double colorless.
Okay.
And then Show and Tell. Then looked at his opponent, who was Atsuki Kihara.
And then he was like, oh shit.
And then his opponent, no Fossil Wheel? Smile. No, he didn't scoop lah. So he dropped the Emrakul. His opponent dropped, I forget what his opponent dropped lah, but basically it was
something
over,
not relevant.
It was not. That's not true. Even close, man.
Not even close, baby.
Like, Emrakul turn one. I was like,
seems good.
What you got?
That was on, well, to be fair, that's a really bold play.
Yeah, like, that's the thing. Like, I really thought he had the Detection Probe to check clear first, but he didn't.
Yeah, but he just grew like big balls that just...
Yeah, it just goes zoop, slam.
Zoop, slam.
So then the second game also ended really quickly. He went turn three Sneak Attack, which got Force of Will. Was it Force of Will or something like that? He got, basically did not resolve. And then he went turn 4 Sneak Attack and then brought in Emrakul.
Okay.
That got Terminus away by Miracles player. So Atsuki was playing Miracles.
Okay.
And then he went turn 5, another Emrakul, because he is so talented at the game.
Wait, but with Sneak Attack?
Yeah, with Sneak Attack. Sneak Attack still around. So he resolved his second Sneak Attack. That was... So, man, his hand was crazy. He had Spell Pierce and whatnot. And basically... he his opponent his opponent had zero cards at the end of the first Sneak Attack. Then Sneak Attack just resolved.
I think this is just talent. Like,
freaking talented.
Thanks again for the free packs, by the way.
Oh my goodness, so hilarious. And I'm watching, okay, so I didn't get to watch the stream, and I was watching the replay. The replay was put up by it's Julius, one of the guys in San Francisco. You know what's his name? Oh man, what, yeah, it's Julius, but he's friends with the Commander Cast guys.
Well, I don't know who they are.
It's Jimmy Wong. Yeah, brother of Freddie Wong.
Really?
Yeah.
Are you serious?
Freddie Dubs.
Freddie Wong?
Yeah. So Freddie Wong? His brother, so Jimmy Wong. Oh. Yeah, everybody says I look like Jimmy Wong, which sometimes I understand, but then I don't usually understand.
I don't know who Jimmy Wong is though, so...
Jimmy Wong, hey, Jimmy! Okay, anyway. Right. So, yeah, I was watching his replay, and his replay was like some... like had Japanese words like scrolling across. It's basically user comments.
Oh.
It was hilarious. And when Kentaro won, it's like, lucky lah. Super lucky.
You lucky.
So yeah, congratulations to this. And the top 8, of course, Yuya, of course, has to be in the top 8. Keisuke Sato, Koichi Miyabe, I hope I'm pronouncing that right. Ryo Takahashi, Shi, Akira Honma, and Liu Jin, who is the only Chinese guy up on the stands.
Wow.
Yeah, you can tell that they're Japanese because they use Gatsby in their, all their hairstyles are like them fantastic.
Yeah.
Kihara is like have zero rings down to here.
So, oh man.
Yeah.
Man, Japanese people. Total glam. Japanese people have like such cool fashion.
Yeah, I can't believe it. Like when, especially in their hometown, right? They're playing. And then they're like, their hair is like up to there. I can just imagine the Gatsby guy like going around with like...
You know when you watch anime, you see those crazy hair, like those aren't exaggerations. Yes, yeah, those are real, by the way.
Okay, so let's move on from the Grand Prix. This week, we are going to talk about a new format that we are going to try out.
Yeah.
Called Smorden.
Yeah.
No, actually, no, it's called Frontier.
Frontier.
Okay, so it has been nicknamed Frontier. Of course, we gave it our own name, which is Postmodern. Officially, it's a casual constructed Magic the Gathering format. And it encompasses all cards that have been printed in a core or expansion set using the M15 card frame. So basically anything M15 onwards, it must have the hologram.
Okay, cool.
Okay. Yeah, and it was started by Hariruya and Big Magic. They said they'll be holding weekly tournaments in this format. It's quite cool. The deck construction is the same as sanctioned formats like Modern and Standard, so forth and so on. The set legality, M15, Khan's Otake, Fate Reforged, Dragon's Otake, Magic Origins, Battle for Zendikar, Oath of the Gatewatch, Shadows over Innistrad, Eldritch Moon, and last but not least, Kaladesh. And that is 10 sets.
Wow.
You got 10 sets to play from. This is slightly more than what Extended would have been.
Mm-hmm.
Extended is only 8 sets from the last set. But yeah, this is 10 sets. Mm-hmm. And that's cool.
Cool.
So, yeah, that's all it says here about Frontier.
Well, cool.
All right.
I think... imagine this. Haruya office meeting. Okay, man. All these bulk rare KTK stuff. We can't move this. What we do, man?
Yeah, we create a new format. We create a new format that requires you to buy all these new cards like fetch lands, like Outpost Sieges, like Tormod's Crypts, like Elvish Mystics.
Oh, damn. You're a genius.
You're a genius.
Oh, you're promoted. Yeah, we'll take it. Yeah.
There's a meme where the guy like makes a weird comment and after they throw him out the window. Let's sell them to another store and after they throw him out the window. That is the Frontier format. And we're gonna go through MTG Goldfish, which apparently has been recording all these decks.
Godless.
The decks. And the Frontier metagame is kind of cool.
It's pretty
right
funny.
Now. I mean, like right now, the first thing you think about Frontier is Khans, right?
Yeah.
I think so. Like, and
I'm thinking about Khans.
Yeah, and the first thing that you think about Khans is
Rally the Ancestors.
Rally the Ancestors. Siege Rhino. What else do we think about? Anna Fenza. Basically, the whole
Fetchlands.
Fetchlands. Yeah. So, that's the first thing that we thought of. But of course, there are better stuff. I mean, there are other things as well. We're seeing a relatively healthy meta. Although, this is a very new format. Mm-hmm. It only has 10 sets in it, which is definitely not enough. When Modern was called, the Return to Mirrodin, the Scars to Mirrodin block.
Okay.
Scars of Mirrodin. That already had a lot of sets from 8th edition. That was 8 years worth of sets. And that is 32 sets.
Whoa,
total.
Cool.
Yeah, 30, you know. Granted, they have small and medium blocks and shit like that. But the thing now is that we have big block, big set, and then medium set. And so, if we continue this trend, we actually get a lot more cards in a very short period of time. So, this Frontier format can actually happen in maybe 2 years' time.
Mm-hmm.
Because last time we used to have big block, big set, small set, and which is essentially big set, medium set.
Uh-huh.
And now, we can squeeze down maybe 8 years to, you take out this thing to about 5 years worth. So far, we've got 2 years worth of stuff. 2.5 years worth of stuff. So we need to wait maybe about 2 more years before they officially call it the Frontier format, or at least one more year before they officially call it a Frontier format. All right, so let's take a look at the decks. We have making out the meta, and when we say it makes up the meta, it's like two decks, like there's a lot. We got Rally Combo, of course. You got Jeskai. Let's go through the decks as we go along. Okay, so let's talk about Rally Combo. And that is the first thing I think that pops to mind when you think about like Rally. And this was at Grand GP Chiba. For the... Well, I won't call it a Super Sunday series, but it's also in Japanese, so I can't read the bloody thing.
Super Sunday series.
We have basically Elvish Visionary, Jace Prodigy, Satire Wayfinder, Zulapok Cutthroat, Catacomb Sifter, and number one, Nantuko Husk.
Oh yeah.
And now you got Spell Queller. Oh well, no, you did we use the Spell Queller? No, right?
No, we didn't.
No, okay, so now you got Spell Queller. And of course the cool thing about the deck is Collector Company. Dig Through Time, and three Rally the Ancestors, which are very cheap right now. So if you want, you better get the bloody Rally the Ancestors. Like,
oh, Rally!
Rally. So, and then it plays some of the fetch lands, some of the dual lands, and plays Evolving Wilds, which is, oh my goodness, seriously, I think you can do better than Evolving
Wilds. What's wrong?
Right?
Why you play Evolving Wilds, man?
4 Flooded Strand, 4 Polluted Delta, 4 Windswept Heath, and after that, 4 2 Evolving
How
Wilds.
How many fetches do you want, man? What? 12 not enough for you? What?
No, but it's got power to dig through time, man.
Oh, right, that's true.
Yeah, the sideboard's quite cool. It's got Nissa World Waker. It's got, of course, Murderous Card. Gideon, which we definitely did not... did we see Gideon in Rally?
Yeah, we
did see Gideon in Rally. Of course, you've got to have Anofenza because it is Abzan colored. Collective Brutality. This one's an interesting sideboard card.
Blessed Alliance.
Blessed Alliance, Natural State, and Dispels. Okay, so cool cards all around.
Cool.
I think the coolest part, or the coolest addition to the deck is, of course, Spell Queller. Reflector Mage, we had it before, but Spell Queller, I think, just puts it slightly over the edge.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that makes up 7.69% of the meta. The price of the deck, $401. We'll do a short breakdown later.
That's then, too much, I think.
Where's the money coming from? The Jaces? So 4 Jaces cost you about $100 right now, which is quite cool because previously 1 Jace would cost you $100. And 4 Collector Companies, which cost you $40, which previously was 1 Collector Company cost you $40. So if you want to get your stuff, better get
it right
now. Actually,
I have all the pieces for that deck right now.
Yeah, I don't have Rally then, that's about it. I need to go
buy
the Jaces.
Just buy it for like 50 cents.
Yeah, exactly.
You need Jaces?
Yeah.
Probably. I have place I can
You need Jace? I have Jace.
I'm not going to play anyway. I'm going to cast. You want it?
No. If I'm not coming here, then I'm not playing.
Oh, well.
Okay, so the other deck that makes up 2.56... not this. Jeskai. The one with... Where is it? Oh, yeah.
Jeskai?
Yeah, Monastery Sea Spear. Oh, man. This one.
Oh, spicy.
Spicy. Kitian, Maduro Reaper, Monastery Suspia, Trouble Inspector, Now the White Orchid, Talia's Lieutenant, Mantis Rider, Reckless Bushwhacker, and Reflector Mage.
Now I want to just highlight, right? Suspia, Mantis Rider, and Lieutenant in the same deck. That's nuts.
Yeah. So that's the thing, like Mantis Rider is a human, by the way. It's not a freaking insect.
Yeah.
This is a human monk riding a freaking mantis. It's good.
It's referring to the rider, not the mantis.
And you have like... it has always watching, for fuck's sake. It has four always watching. Oh my god. Like, this is so weird.
This deck is over the top.
18 lands. It's only got 4 fetch lands though. So
4, 2.
No, 2 prairie... Oh, right. The prairie streams are... Yeah, it's only got 2 flooded strands, of course, because, you know, you don't want to... You don't want to die, from putting just too much mana. But yeah, Mantis Rider. May we get to see Mantis Rider again?
Yeah, my favorite card, man.
Oh, so annoying, this card. And this deck costs $181.
That's okay.
Yeah, that's okay.
Considering you have like most of the pieces anyway, so
yeah, the main cost of the deck is the Always Watching, which is very strange, and the lands, of course, the Flooded Strand and the Inspiring Vantage. So maybe get your Flooded Strands now.
Yeah.
Who knows? Okay, let's go down. Mono Red, and this one is $50, $48 to build. I love this. Foundry Street Denizen, Frenzied Goblin.
Oh boy, this is goblins.
Yeah, this is goblins. Goblin Power Driver, Goblin Rebel Master, Reckless Bushwhacker does not even run Monastery Swisspear. That's how goblin-ish it is.
You know goblin.
Stoke the Flames, Hordling Outburst, Teemer Battle Rage. And this Teemer Battle Rage is definitely going on like a Goblin Power Driver, Goblin Rebel Master, of course. And then the Obelisk of Earth.
Obelisk of Third.
Hey, this was the deck. I mean, this was the deck back in when M15, you know, at the end of Khans, where you have like Obelisk of Earth, and after you have like the all the goblins.
Yeah, yeah.
And stuff. And then 20 Mountains. That's it. That's the deck. $50. Very cheap if you want to try to build. Cheap, cheap.
Next deck,
Bound Eldrazi. So
wait, what?
Weird.
Is it modern now?
Yeah, this is Elvish Mystics, Dustwatch Recruiters, Eldrazi Displacer, Sky Spawner, Meta Reshaper, 4 Thought-Not Seers, 4 Reality Smashers, 1 Verdurous Gilhawk.
Whoa.
Yeah, that made it in there. 2 Drown of Hope. Then you've also got one Tamiyo and 1 Nissa Nature's Artisan.
Wait, this is the
like,
duo
deck? What the heck, right? This is the duo deck one.
Reveal the top 2 cards of your library, put all lands drawn at the battlefield and rest of your hand. What?
Because of that clause.
Question mark.
No, reveal. Okay, so you reveal the top 2 cards of your library. It's basically draw 2 cards.
Yeah.
And if they are lands, you put them onto the battlefield. So it's not dead cards.
What the heck?
Yeah, what the heck, right? But it has Nissa's Nature's Artisan. What the hell? Like, this is crazy. It's got Stubborn Denials, Deck in Stone, and Spatial Contortion. And it's got Oath of Nissa so that you can cast your Tamiyo and your Nissa Nature's Artisan.
My brain is contorting already.
Yeah, it is. Oh my gosh. What the hell, man?
Just to point out, like, this looks like a normal Ben Eldrazi list from, like, Modern. Except like the except for Noble Hierarchs, it's Elvish Mystics, so
yeah, exactly, you know, and then you got Dustwatch Recruiters, which well I don't know what they replaced, but yeah, what the hell, man, this deck is so jank.
It went 3-2, so
yeah, it went 3-2 at the Frontier Cup, their weekly Frontier tournament.
That's okay.
Then let's go through some of the decks that we... the last one, Esper. So let's get some representation.
Oh boy, this is not Esper.
This is not Esper. 2 Torrential Gearhawk and that's it. That's the creatures. That's all the creatures. And this is a new card.
No, look at the list. This is not Esper.
This is Mono Blue. This is Mono Blue with Silumgas Command and it has... where's the white card?
This is Mono Blue Prison.
Yeah. Yeah, this is Mono Blue Prison.
Where's the white card? This is Esper. There's no white. Know. This is Mono Blue Prison Splash Black. What? Get your shit together, Goldfish.
4 Anticipate, so 2 Disdainful Stroke, 3 Hydro Lash. I don't like Hydro Lash, but okay. 4 Pieces of Puzzle, 4 Engulf the Shore, 2 Aether Spouts, 1 Silumgas Command, 4 Part the Water Veil, 4 Dig Through Time. And the reason why I like this deck so much, because it has the Dig Through Time. The Part the Water Veil, like, okay. 4 Dig Through Time, man.
Oh, yeah.
4 Prism Ring.
Mono Blue Prison with Part the Water Veil. I mean, Mono Blue Prison with Dig Through Time. I think that's the thing.
That's the one that pushes it over the top. And it has Disdainful Stroke. And this is so important. Disdainful Stroke is one of those cards where, like, it defined control decks back in the day, because you could go Disdainful Stroke and then do something else on turn 4.
Yeah.
Like, that is what you wanted to do. You want to go Disdainful Stroke, then not anticipate, you Dig Through Time.
Oh, right.
By that point, you like exhausted all your outs and after you just go Dig Through Time. Aether Spouts also very cool. Engulf the Shores, yeah. So, Weird deck, man. Weird deck. Yeah, this is not Esper, dude.
This is Mono Blue Prison.
Mono Blue, yeah. This is Mono Blue Prison.
Why you lie to us?
Yeah, not cool.
Why you lie?
Alright, let's go through some of the archetypes that you might also see. You got Jhan, you got Abzan, of course. And a lot of the cards that are here on the face are either Collected Company or Smuggler's Copter, which we'll talk about in a bit. Let's talk about the Ensole Aggro one.
Ensole Topter is bad.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Wait,
oh,
wait, where's Ornithopter? It's not here.
What? Oh, yeah, there's no Ornithopter.
No!
No, but there is... What's the card? There's a Smuggler's Copter.
That's the new Ornithopter. Yeah, boy.
Holy crap, 2 mana, Smuggler's Copter.
Don't even need to crew it now. It's a 5/5 fly with loot.
Four Hangerbite Walkers, 4 Trouble Inspectors, 4 2 Craft Exemplar, 4 Scrap Heap Scrounger. And this one's the weird one. 2 Kambal.
Kambal.
I don't know why. 2 Thalia Heretics, 4 Shrapnel Blast. This one's damn good. Instant Speed deal 5 damage. Unlicensed Disintegration. And then we have the Ghost Fire Blade, Smuggler's Copter, and Cultivator's Caravan.
This
and
is Jeskai Black artifact. Colors.
This is Jeskai. Yeah, this is Jeskai Black.
Yeah.
No, it's more like Mardu Blue. Because Ensole Artifact is the splash.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, can you imagine, like, you have Smuggler's Copter and then Ensole Artifact? Or you have. No. How about this? Trouble Inspector. And then Ensole Artifact on the clue. Right?
Oh my god, that's a
so
thing.
So good, right?
That's a thing. I did not even realize.
Oh my goodness, then you smash it for 6 the next turn. This is more damage than you usually do with like Ornithopter or
that's
like.
Hilarious.
Yeah, but look at that. Like, Smuggler's Copter and Ensole Artifact, man, this is something that I need to build. Like, I have all the pieces already, yeah. So. This deck seems fun. $140. Most of the money is in, of course, the Inspiring Vantage, as well as the Smuggler's Copters. A playset of Smuggler's Copters, $48.
Which I'm pretty sure all the standard players have.
If you're playing standard right now, like this is, so this is the cool part about Frontier is that if you're playing standard right now,
you probably already have the cards,
and some of the cards are not expensive, especially if you just join standard. You know, you have your deck for that spans all the way back to BFZ. All you have to do is get the Khan's Origins and the M15 cards. And now, start your collection because there is going to be the second format. Like, I assure you. Like, there's definitely going to be the second format. Okay, so what else do we want to talk about? Multicolor control?
You mean Jeskai Black?
It's Jeskai Black, yeah.
It is Jeskai Black.
4 Jaces, 4 Soulfire Grandmasters, 4 Mantis Rider, which I like to see. This is not control, this is just Jeskai Black.
Yeah,
1 Tassigur and 1 Torrential Gearhawk. This made it in there.
So
and the list is almost exactly the same. Got 3 Fiery Impulse, 2 Collective Brutalities, which I like.
Cool.
2 Disdainful Strokes, 4 Crackling Dooms, 2 Kologan's Commands, 2 Painful Truths, 1 Ojitai's Command, and 4 Dig Through Time. And of course, it's got 26 lands, but it's got 12 fetches.
Whoa, cool.
A little too much, if you ask me. But,
this is the money deck.
This is the money deck because it costs $427.
You rich fags.
Yeah, $430. Jace, again, 4 copies of Jace, 4 copies of Polluted Delta, 4 copies of Bloodstained Mire, and 4 copies of Flooded Strand. The fetch lands cost at least $50. Polluted Deltas are $60. And the 4 Jaces. Like, this is extravagant. Yeah. Let's just say. But guess what? This is the suggest a better. Oh, there's a suggest a better name here. Okay, anyway, they don't have the player name, but they have the deck list and that's the deck. Like, it's a bit too much though. If you put in like 12 fetch lands,
yeah.
And clearly, this guy has been playing standard for quite a while. Has all the cards and just put all the most expensive cards together.
You know, why not?
Yeah, why not, right?
Why not?
We also have like elves and humans and any other weird stuff. We have Grixis Dragons in this one.
Oh, that's my... I used to play this deck standard last time.
Yeah?
Yeah, I used to play this deck.
So Greek Six Dragons, 4 Thunderbreak Regions, 3 Kologan Storm's Fury, and 2 Torrential Gearhound.
Oh, this was my favorite. Turn 4 Thunderbreak, turn 5 Swing for a billion damage.
Yeah, exactly. You know, just like a lot of quite a few counter spells and removal, like Draconic Ross and Gascon, and just this is Dragon Control. This is Grixis Dragon Control.
Yeah.
$330.
Although I would take out the 2 Hangar Walkers for 2 more Jaces though. I'll take out the 2 Hangar Max for 2 more Jaces.
That's in the sideboard?
No, the creatures.
Oh, okay. We're looking at different really? Lists then. I'm looking at the Grixis Dragon. Oh, yeah, okay. So there's another Grixis Dragon Control. I'm looking at the one at the bottom of the list, which may be not the best. Yeah, 2 Hangerback Walker, 2 Jace, 2 Kalitas, 4 Thunderbreak Regen, 4 Kologan Storm Fury, 1 Dragonlord Kologan, and 1 Silumga.
Where's the Silumga Scorn? Where is it? Hey, come on, man.
No, that was in the... You look at the last one on the list.
No, this one doesn't have Silumga Scorn.
Oh yeah, this one doesn't have Silumga Scorn.
Hey, lousy deck, no Silumga Scorn. I like Stubborn Denial though. Stubborn Denial is really good.
Oh man, Stubborn Denial so good. Like, it's just a blowout. I used to play the Sultai Reanimator deck.
Oh yeah.
I can get my apes on turn 2, and then just like keep up, just counter magic like this thing, full strokes and Silumga Scorn. Not Silumga Scorn. Stubborn Denial. Yeah, you can't do shit. You can't do stuff. Alright, we are going to talk about what the cool cards are and what each of the blocks bring. Let's start with M15. Urborg, Stoke the Flames. We also got the Painlands.
Obelisk of Third.
Obelisk of Earth. Tormod's Crypt.
Rebel Master.
And Soul Artifact. And I think this is the most important one.
Darksteel Citadel?
No, not Darksteel. Elvish Mystic.
Ooh!
Oh yeah! Elvish Mystic, definitely.
Ramp is back, baby.
Yeah, man.
Speaking of ramp, where's the ramp deck?
No, not there yet.
Oh.
Yet. Because we got no Sylvan. This thing we got.
But if a turn one ramp, come on, man.
Yeah, I know. Right? Go like turn 1 to turn 3.
Turn
so
one,
good, right?
Turn
so
one, Elvish Mystic. Turn 2, Nissa's Pilgrimage. Like, what?
No, turn 2, Nissa.
Turn 2, Nissa?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Nissa, look for another forest. Like, you could use the Voice of Zendika, or you could use the Flip Nissa.
Oh, yeah.
Anyway.
Yeah, cool.
In the Khan's block, of course, we got the Fetchers. We got Swift Spear. We got all the Delve cards, and I think the most important Delve cards are Murderous Cut, Tarsigur. Yeah.
Dig Through Time.
D2T.
Treasure Cruise.
Yeah, I'm surprised that we don't see enough Treasure Cruise in this format. Nothing's got banned yet, of course. But I think if anything were to be banned, it would be Treasure Cruise.
Hey, please out, Dona.
Because everything, you know, everybody will just play blue.
Please out, Dona. Please out.
Monastery Mentor, Soulfire Dragon Master, Soulfire whatever master,
Grandmaster.
We got the Dragon Lords. We got the miniature version of the Dragon Lords. We got Rally. We got Commands. I think very important. We got Collected Company. Gross card. We still have Company. I don't want to play a format with fucking Company.
I don't want to play that stuff.
Disdainful Stroke. We have Abzan,
Rhinos, Mantis Riders,
Anafenzas. And I think this one we haven't seen it in a lot of lists. I think it's going to be quite important. Teamer Battle Rage, bang bang.
Can you imagine? Okay, you thought Electro Sanctum Pummeler was cool. Wait till Pummeler with Teamer Battle Rage.
Oh yeah, like 2 mana. Against Trample and Double Strike, yo.
Like what?
What?
Yeah, that's exactly what it needs.
Yeah, exactly. Like, you don't need to go past 3 mana anymore.
Yeah, you can just like go with like Titan Strength or something.
Turn one, Elvish Mystic.
Oh boy.
Turn 2, Pummeler. Okay, you can't palm out the Pummeler that far. Oh no, you can. Can you?
You can't. You need a 2 to Aether and some other stuff.
Yeah, okay. Then you need to build up. So maybe turn 3. So turn 1, Elvish Mystic. Turn 2, a 2 with Aether, Servant of Conduit. No, yeah, there's some other ways that you can build up energy. Anyway, whatever. Yeah. Cool deck.
Cool, cool.
Let's move on to Origins. Origins, we got the Flip Walkers, Jace, Kitian, I think, seeing a lot of play.
Yeah.
We've got Hangerback Walker.
Oh, oh boy.
Gosh, hard card to deal with. You got Knight of the White Orchid, which is like, okay.
Yeah.
You got Nantuko Husk, which, you know, enables the rally. It's one of the free sec outlets. You got Topters, all the Topters stuff.
Top.
And you have the Elf combo. You basically have Elf Tribe in Origins.
Yeah.
And plus the Collector Company from the previous
set. Call of Calling.
And then you got Call of... Oh, yeah, I forgot. That's M15.
Yeah, yeah.
Forgot Call of Calling. Let me add it in here. Alright, so then we head on over to Zendikar. And Zendikar, not many new
Kalitas.
Cards. You got Kalitas.
Gideon.
You got... oh yeah, you got Gideon. I forgot about Gideon.
Bigots.
You got Dual Lands.
Mm-hmm.
And that's actually very important in the format. You got Painful Truths. And you also got Eldrazi's.
Oh boy.
Thought not here.
Let's not forget that now we have Pain Lands. Try less for Eldrazi again.
Yeah, exactly. So Eldrazi's, and then you got Ambusher.
Oh boy.
Ambusher is very powerful. Like, I think people just forget.
You mean Bushwrecker?
Yeah, the Bushwrecker. Is it? No, no. It's Reckless.
Reckless Bushwrecker.
Is it Reckless Bushwrecker?
Dude, what the heck?
No, it is Reckless Bushwrecker is the first one.
Yeah.
This one is...
What's Ambusher?
Oh, it's Reckless Bushwrecker, right. Oh, the other one is the... I forget what Ambusher, but like the one where you have to pay...
No, the kicker? That's Goblin Bushwrecker.
Oh, that's Goblin Bushwrecker. Okay, so this is Reckless Bushwrecker. Okay,
wow.
Cool. I don't know, man.
Hey,
I forget.
Hey. You old as me, what?
Yeah, I know. Oh, so they're both Bushwreckers, lah.
Yeah.
Whack.
The bush.
Whack your bush.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah. Alright, so we move on to Innistrad. Innistrad, we got, of course, got the human synergy. You gotta add even more humans. You got Talia's lieutenants and shit like that. Declaration in stone, which is not instant speed though. We don't have any path to exile type of effect. So Arthur removal N. is not the
Arthur N.
No. Removal is not the best. It's not as efficient. You got Everseen, but we're not seeing play of Everseen. Then you got the spirits, which include Mausoleum Wanderer,
okay,
which I think is going to be quite important. We've got Selfless Spirit as well. And of course, you got Liliana's, which are not seeing play, but you got like some of the powerful planeswalkers there. Liliana's, Tamios. Tamio, I think, will do more damage in this format because it's more of a tempo game. Tamio is a very tempo card.
Mm-hmm.
Last but not least, we have Kaladesh. And Kaladesh, we got all the Topter stuff.
Got Copters.
And then we got Smuggler's Copter. That's it. We got Torrential Gearhawk, right? Which we are seeing play, which is the control, like
the control god.
Now we know, you know, no more what's that card?
What card? Dig Through Time?
No, not Dig Through Time. Oh my gosh.
What card? What does it do?
Torrential Gearhawk, Dig Through Time. No, we got no Snapcaster Mage. So that's the problem. So, like previously, you can like Snapcaster, you dig through time, like go through half your library, and after that, just draw out more cards, and then you go like Snapcaster, dig through time, and then draw even more cards. Man, feels so good. Feels
that's not fun.
Alright, so we got all these cards in Frontier. What's so appealing about Frontier? So, I think it's just...
It's cheap,
for sure. It's a fresh format.
Fresh, like, new, funky.
Okay, well, let's talk about it's cheap. Let's go back to the... Before we jump the gun. Cheap. We're looking at all the deck prices. They are... You know, they range from like $50 to $450. But even saying that, right? That being said...
you probably have the cards.
Yeah, you probably have the cards.
Why would you sell your fetches, man? Who sells their fetches at this time?
I don't know. Some people did, and that's unfortunate. But you know, you can get back your fetches as soon as you.
Yeah, because fetches right now are really cheap.
Mm-hmm. So, you know, and the prices, like, these are cards that nobody uses in Modern. Yeah. A lot of these cards are things that people don't use in Modern, especially like Jaces.
Yeah.
You don't use them in Modern. Rebel Master, definitely not being used in Modern. Those cards that have rotated out, Thunderbreak Regions, used to be $10 a piece. Now yeah. it's $4.40 for a playset.
Damn.
Yep. Well, Torrential Gearhawk still being used in the format. Dig Through Time used to be $5 a piece, at least. It used to be, when I was playing, it's like 10 euro, which is about $17, mm-hmm. Which maybe like 12, 13 USD. Mm-hmm. Now it's $4 for a playset.
Damn.
So these are cheap cards, man. These are not expensive. You talk about even cards that are in standard rotation right now, like Sunken Hollows, all the dual lands from BMC. They're not expensive. They're not. Yeah. They're not terribly cheap. They're not expensive at all. And we talk about the fetch lands. They're not expensive yeah, either. Yeah. So if you want to pick up your, you know, you want to pick up Frontier, mm-hmm. see, you know, just buy the cards first. Just build up your library, because this is going to be a format.
Yeah.
Like, no joke, this will be a format.
By the way, mate, do you have like specs, playset of Deltas?
No.
Shit.
Gotta go buy those.
Damn.
I don't get, and if I have extras, right, they go into my EDH decks.
She's bad, man.
So I have like, I think seven Halo Fountains.
Seven
Halo Fountains, because Blue White is my favorite. Blue White is my favorite color. I got seven Halo Fountains, seven what's the fetch land for
Blue
it? Flooded Strands. Yeah. Blue White is just my favorite. And Polluted Deltas, I got five. But one of them's in like all the decks. Anyway. So number one is cheap. It's not as expensive as Modern. Modern is just insane. Modern decks go up to like $600+.
No, 2000s.
Yeah, into the thousands. You know, minimum price is like the most accessible deck, which is Mono Red, or the Naya Burn decks. And those are already $300+ because the lands are expensive. And here, Frontier, the which is the second part of second reason why I think Frontier is so appealing, is because the power level is high.
Yeah.
But it's not unfair.
For now. You know,
for now, because we don't have effective removal. We don't have efficient removal. We have effective removal in the form of like Fiery Impulse and shit like that. But it's not as good as, oh, Path to Exile, bye bye creature. You get a land, but what are you going to do with it? Or Lightning Bolt. Bolt your creature. Yeah.
Cool.
So... that is two reasons. And the third reason is because there are no unfair decks, which is great, because no Affinity.
Oh man.
No Tron.
Oh man.
No Infect. No Eidolon of the Great Revel. You know, what other decks are so oppressive? No Ad Nauseam.
Oh man.
You know, so all these decks are like oppressive and just unfair. No Living End. No Restore Balance. You know, no Ancestral Recall. You still got Jhan, and Jhan is the most fair deck that you can have. And even then Jhan becomes a lousy deck because it's too fair. Like, and Jhan is powerful.
Yeah.
It feels like weight off my shoulder. Like, you don't have to play against Affinity or Tron or Infect. Infect is like, oh, do you have the path? No, you die.
Oh man.
Do you have the bolt? No, you die. And even if sometimes you got the bolt, you still die.
Do you have the block? You can't block.
You can't block, yeah. So this is you know, Merfolk is a fair deck. Merfolk, Spirits is a fair deck.
Yeah. Like Fairies are fair.
Spirits.
Fairies.
Fairies are fair. Fairies are a fair deck. It's just that you let them get out of control and then you die.
Hate Bears are fair.
Hate Bears are fair. Oh yeah, we don't have to play against Hate Bears. There's no hate cards.
There's no hate bears cards
in the format. Except for maybe, what's that? That 3-1 flyer. So we got Harshwing Griff. We also got... is Harshwing Griff...
No, it's not.
Harshwing Griff is not in the format.
No. Otherwise, we have seen some tech against Siege Rhinos.
No, it's in 2015.
Oh, is it?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Harshwing Griff, we also have Talia, Heretic Qatar, but they're not at 2 mana. So it's more, a bit more fair, you know. Yeah. So there is three main reasons why, yeah, Frontier is an exciting thing. I think, you know, you own the cards, it's cheap, and yeah, you can look into it. You should start looking into it.
Yeah.
All right. That's actually also, I guess, our pick of the week, which is to start buying Frontier cards.
Buy some fetch lands.
The fetch lands are important. I think Mantis Riders and stuff like that. I just need one more copy to complete my playset, so I'll just go buy.
You want my taxi bank signed one?
The Mantis Rider?
Yeah.
Sure, why not? Yeah, I'll buy it. Okay, so I need to go and look into this. We are going to go into Judge Call.
Judge.
Okay.
That was kind of okay.
Yeah. That was totally okay.
Yeah.
That was very okay. This week I had there were a lot of new players. And so with a lot of new players, like, fumbles start to happen. You're supposed to look at three cards, but then you look at four.
Yeah.
People call judge. Like, people don't want to call the judge. And that's what I hate about new players, is that they don't have the instinct to, like, just raise up their hand. And, like, at the PPTQ last week that I was playing,
yeah,
this one guy just every round had to call a judge. Because I don't know why.
Well, why?
He just went, like, judge, and like really shouted out on top of his voice. I'm like, dude, relax. The room is encompassed. We're in a bomb shelter.
That is one guy every time.
I think it's that one guy.
I think it's every.
So like, I made a comment like, because I'm a judge myself. So I went by like this thing. I went to CJ and was like, hey, this guy every round go call judge one. What the hell is his problem, man? Don't know. So that's one thing I hate about new players, that they need to call the judge, because you can resolve stuff by yourself, but you're not supposed to. Well, you can resolve it between players if you're amenable, but it's best to call a judge to go and find out what is the actual ruling and why. And I think that's the most important thing.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we're going to talk about is this IPG 2.2 gameplay error. Looking at extra cards. So this IPG section 2.2, and you can look it up yourself. The definition is, a player looks at a card they were not entitled to see. Players are considered to have looked at a card when they have been able to observe the face of a hidden card, or when a card is moved any significant amount from a deck but before it touches cards in another set. So we need to define a set. A set is a physically distinct group defined by a game rule or effect. It may correspond to a specific zone or may only represent a part of a zone. This includes errors of dexterity or catching a play error before the card is placed into his or her hand. Once a card has been placed into his or her hand, the offense is no longer looking at extra cards. The offense is drawing extra cards. Or there is also hidden card error. Hidden card error we'll discuss another time, because that one is a little complicated. Next, a player is not considered to have looked at extra cards when he or she places a card face down on the table without looking at the card in an effort to count out cards. So for example, if you're laying cards on the table to
count
your opening hand.
Oh, okay.
So like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, you forgot your mulligan. So this is the 7th card. So this is not considered at looking at extra cards, because the cards are face down.
But can this be rectified?
This can be rectified. This is like hidden card error. This is very similar to hidden card error. Basically, if both of you know the order, if both of you and your opponent know the order, then you put it back. Otherwise, so hidden card error, you basically take the three cards. So for me, traditionally, I put like three cards and then four cards. You would take the set that is messed up. You shuffle it, and then you put it back on top of the deck, and then you draw three cards from that.
Oh.
Yeah.
That sounds...
That's hidden card error.
Okay.
So it's not so bad. It's not as bad as that. It's supposed to be drawing extra cards, but drawing extra cards gets you a penalty of basically lose the game. All right. This penalty is applied only once if one or more cards are seen in the same action or sequence of events. So basically, you just look at an extra card. Okay, yeah, not draw an extra card or not hidden card error. So, example, a player accidentally reveals, drops, flips over, and we say unintentionally, maybe, hopefully, a card while shuffling his or her opponent's deck. Okay, or B, a player pulls up an extra card while drawing from his or her deck. And C, a player sees the bottom card of his or her deck when presenting it to her opponent for cutting or shuffling. Okay, so that's looking at extra cards. So they know they got some extra information of what's where. So the remedy is to... Alright, so the remedy is basically to... If you know the set, and this is looking at extra cards, you're supposed to randomize the randomized portion of the deck. So if he, let's say, drew four cards off of the, let's say, Grim Flayer, and then he looked at it. So if you don't know the order, what?
Is it three?
It's supposed to be three, correct? Yeah. But you look at four. So if you don't know the order, and both, like your opponent does not have to corroborate. At a regular Ariel, what will probably happen is that you shuffle up the cards, you put one card back on top, so a random card back on top, you shuffle up the deck. Oh, that's it. Okay. That's looking at extra cards. So now you're left with three cards. In competitive Ariel, two things might happen. Okay, so but usually I think this is what happens is that your opponent gets to look at the top four cards. He takes out that one card that's not supposed to be there, puts it back on top of the deck, and then you shuffle the deck. Then they have those three cards left.
Oh, cool.
Oh, yeah. And then you get a penalty.
That sucks.
gameplay error. There's an additional remedy. Shuffle any previously unknown cards into the random portion of the deck, then put any known cards back in their correct locations. Oh, yeah. Before you shuffle the deck. This one I forgot the other day. Before you shuffle the deck, ask your opponent or ask the person who you're about to shuffle the deck, do you scry anything to the bottom?
Oh.
Because that is the known portion of the deck. It's not you shuffle up the entire deck. So this is, you put the known portions back to known locations. So if he say, oh, I scry five cards to the bottom of the deck already. So then you take out five, you put it on the table, you shuffle the rest of the deck, then you put it back on the table.
Oh, right. Okay.
You do not, okay, so one of the things that we are told is to not repeat the action. Okay, which means that
don't make a mistake again.
No, not don't make the mistake. As in don't repeat the action. So for example, if let's say I am trying to cheat, what I can do is Grim Flayer, I hit you, I draw two cards, and then I see shit, this is not what I want to be seeing. And then now I draw an additional two cards. And then I realize my mistake. I call the judge. And then the judge gives the wrong this thing. So these four cards are not what I want to put in the graveyard. Or basically not what I want to have.
Okay.
I put all four cards back. I shuffle the entire library with the known and unknown portions. And then now I draw another three cards and look at it. So that's repeating the action.
Oh.
You're not supposed to do that. You're supposed to minimize doing that. So you now take, that's why you take out one random card. Since you don't know the order, you take out one random card, you put it back, and then you shuffle up the rest of the deck.
Okay.
Yeah? So you get the idea, right?
Yeah, like,
The idea is not to give your opponent a mulligan.
Yeah.
Players should not use this penalty to get a free shuffle or to attempt to shuffle away cards they don't want to draw. Doing so may be unsporting conduct, cheating. Okay, so that will upgrade and then they'll get you DQ. Players are also not allowed to use this penalty as a stalling mechanism. The deck is already randomized, so shuffling in the revealed cards should not involve excessive effort. Because the rest of the deck is random anyway, just put the card in somewhere, it becomes a random part of the deck. That is looking at extra cards, and it happened a lot on the weekend. It happened a lot on Tuesday. Actually, it happened a lot when I was judging, or so called judging, because I was playing as well. So like people are just looking at extra cards, and have to this thing. There was a point of time where on the stream, the guy looked at extra cards and I said, it's okay, man. Just because they're new players. It's like, okay, so I'm going to explain what's going to happen. But because I was watching, I knew exactly what was the top card of the deck. I just put it back on the top card, top of the deck. I'm not going to shuffle your library. You just continue playing as is. Yeah.
Oh,
because they're new players. I don't want to penalize them like way too much. But the proper procedure is, once you put the card back on the top of the deck, if you know what the last card was, then you shuffle that card away. Mm-hmm. Yeah. If you were watching. So if you're not watching, then you take a random card and you put it on the top of the deck.
Mm.
Yeah. All right. So that is our judge call for this week. And that's
a really
our
long judge call.
That was something that you need to explain. Like this
is something
that I think people try to abuse. This is something that definitely is abusable.
Mm-hmm.
For sure. Because if I thought of ways to do it right, I can get that free shuffle. Mm. But you're not supposed to get that free shuffle. Shuffle. Yeah.
Shuckle.
And if you make a mistake, your opponent gets like a free thought seize.
Oh.
Almost. Yeah.
Pseudo thought seize.
Yeah. Can you imagine like you go, let's say like Satire Wayfinder.
Yeah.
Five cards. So you're supposed to go with four cards, reveal four cards, right?
Yeah.
And then you reveal five cards. And then in there, there's only one land. Oh, so no. In competitive REL, your opponent gets to look at the five cards, pick out the best card in there, and then shuffle it back in your deck. Obviously, they're going to take the land, right?
Yeah.
And then now your Satire Wayfinder just like got nothing.
Oh, well.
Lol. Okay, so...
Ripple, man.
All right, we're going to end off the episode. You've been listening to the Power 9 Podcast. If you're just listening, you can watch us on YouTube.com. Just put in there Power 9 Podcast. If you like the video, please do share and subscribe because it helps us tremendously. The more you subscribe, the more subscribers we have, then we can just change it to Power 9 Podcast. YouTube.com/Power9Podcast, which is great. But if you're just listening to the episode, that's fine too. You can find us on iTunes. I'm sure you know that you can find us on MTG Cast, and you can definitely find us new episodes every week, power9podcast.com. You can find us on Facebook, facebook.com/power9podcast. You can find us on Instagram at power9podcast, and you can find us on Twitter at power9podcast. The 9 is a number 9. You can find myself at The Asian Judge. You can find Alfian at
Oatpressive.
You can also find us streaming Tuesday and Wednesday nights. And right now I'm streaming Final Fantasy 15. I'm not talking, I'm just playing the game and streaming. So
it's boring.
It's boring. It's super boring, but you get to watch the game, I guess.
Yeah.
I don't want to comment because I also want to enjoy the game.
Cool.
Yeah, I will start. Anyway, you can find us twitch.tv/TheAsianJudge, twitch.tv/GreyOgreGames. Is that all that we used to say? I'm not sure.
Yeah.
Alright, for myself and Alfian, we'll be back next week. See you guys. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Ciao.